Baked animations are great, but sometimes they don't exactly line up with our desired gameplay. In this video, you'll see how to do exactly that by example of a T-Rex that comes with a standard animation, but it doesn't quite line up with eating the humans off the ledge. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy. Here to help you. Ooh, me? Yes, you! Make your game dev dream become reality by helping you build more immersive gameplay with inverse kinematics. As with all videos in the series, you can get the full project on GitHub for free, and you can play the full game on itch for free as well. So feel free to check it out and follow along. Now the problem I have this lovely T-Rex, and he eats people, it's beautiful, just he eats them off the ground, and he needs to pluck them for my game off the ledge of the towers and the walkways. So I really needed to retarget that head to exactly line up with the unit that he's eating. Unity has a great package called the Animation Rigging Package, which has some components that help us solve this retargeting problem. I'll have a link in the description to some documentation, which honestly isn't the best documentation, but it shows you how each of the constraints works and gives you a high level overview of what they do. Now, before we get into exactly what I did and how the Animation Rigging Package solved this problem, it's important to say, what is inverse kinematics and how does it work? When a model is animated, there's a series of transforms that represent the skeleton that we're animating. And really all we're doing when we animate something is moving around these transforms. And each transform has some vertices that are associated with it. So as we move it, it affects these different vertices of the animated mesh, depending on how it was configured in the 3D modeling program. In fact, in Unity, if you just move those transforms around while it's not animated, you can pose a model however you'd like. And effectively, that's really all that the animator is doing, is moving and rotating these transforms over multiple frames. Inverse kinematics, or IK, is not strictly an animation thing, but that's the slant that we're looking at in this video. IK is some code that solves, if I want to get to this point and I have these bones, how do I optimally get there based on some constraints? That sounds like a perfect match for us because we know a target point, we know the skeleton, but we don't know how to make our stuff exactly get there. So that's what the IK is doing for us. I'm gonna be using the chain IK constraint from the Unity Animation Rigging Package because I have a chain of bones. I have the head and multiple neck bones down to some point on that skeleton where we want it to stop and say, okay, that's as far down as we're gonna go. And we want the IK to consider all of these bones, all of these points, and make them all move in conjunction with one another to get us to that target point. A very common component for simpler hierarchies like an arm or a leg or something is the two bone IK constraint, which works kind of similarly, but only on two bones. If you're looking for something like that, I've got a video where I animated a llama stomping using the two bone IK constraint. I'll have a link in the description to that video. Now back to dinos. The chain IK constraint wants the root, that's the farthest down the skeleton that we want to go, and the tip, that's the last bone that we want to animate. And it's going to try to put that tip at the target position, which is a game object transform. And this also doesn't like to be reassigned at runtime. So I typically go where I have a child object under our model, we assign that, and then we just move it wherever we want to go. Now the settings and that top weight is really where the magic happens. All of these except those bones, that target, and this maintain target offset, you can change at runtime. The system really doesn't like it if you change any of these, you have to restart play mode for it to work. Let's take a closer look at how each of these works. To set it up, all you need to do is select your model, go to animation rigging after you import it, and say rig setup, and then it will attach this rig builder for you with a rig, and then underneath that rig, you create some new child constraint game objects. Like I made chain IK and it's a child of rig. If it's not a child of rig, it won't work. And you just wanna make sure that whenever you do the setup, you have rig builder on your root object, you have a rig object underneath that's labeled rig with some weight, probably one. And then you start creating your constraint objects underneath them, attaching whatever constraint types you want to have. Now let's take a closer look at some of these settings. Just lock the inspector and we'll move around the IK target. So we have maintain target offset none. Let's move this a little bit forward. If we adjust the weight here, let's max everything out except max iterations, that's probably fine. And as we max out the weight, we'll see that the dino is trying his really hardest to get this head transformed to this location. So if we move it up, he stands up tall and pretty, or he can go really low. So you can even like animate something like he runs funny like this. But we can run into some challenges, especially if it gets too close, because notice he'll start like collapsing his head on himself and you can get some really unnatural positions. So the position of this is quite important that we pick a good one. So assuming we pick some kind of reasonable location, like in front of him, The chain rotation weight is how much should we try to get to this position? One gets us all the way there. Zero, we basically don't move it at all. And it doesn't really matter where we move it. He's not moving anywhere. The tip rotation weight is, like it sounds, how much should this object try to mirror the rotation of our IK target? So if you want it to be exact and you position your rotation exactly where you want it, you can max this out. You can also have it be a little bit less forceful so you get some of your original animation and it's just influenced by the IK. Max iterations, typically higher values get you better results, but also are more expensive. Lower values may give you worse results, but is much more performant. I find a value like 20 is usually pretty good. Tolerance is how close to the target that tip has to be before it says, okay, that's good enough. On this large model, all of these values look the same, but on smaller models, you may need to play with this value to get it to look right. Now that we've taken a look at some of these settings, let's take a look at the maintain target offset. There's four values possible, none, which is what we were just looking at, which gives you full freedom to move around any way you want. Position and rotation will ensure that the original offset of each bone is maintained, as well as the rotation. So we can see a lot better looking, here, let's max this out, until we get to like some really extreme angles. This tends to look pretty good, but we can still end up in some bad scenarios. Here, if we rotated the tip as well, it looks a little bit more realistic. And then you can choose, oh, I only care about the position or only care about the rotation. We'll just quickly take a look at these. Using only position, you can see we still end up with some potentially questionable scenarios, but it's still noticeably better than the none when we place the IK target at a bad position. It starts to look unnatural because we're not maintaining those initial position offsets. So those are allowed to be overridden to whatever the IK system wants to set. For rotation, I haven't really come across a scenario where maintain target offset rotation really gives us that much different result than none. If you've had good results with this, let me know the scenario in the comments. All right, now that we've messed with this poor T-Rex and made him do all kinds of weird stuff, I want to get into a quick interlude to give a huge shout out to polyperfect, who provided basically all of the art assets you see in this video and in this game for free under an educational use only license. That means if you're downloading this full free project off GitHub, you can play around with it, learn whatever you want, but to use it in your game, you have to buy these assets. Topics like this one just aren't possible without animations and models, which are really hard to come by for free. So a huge shout out for polyperfect. Without them, this video wouldn't be possible. Use my affiliate link down in the description to purchase the assets to show your support for polyperfect and this project. Now that looks cool, but how do we only do this on attack? Because we don't want him to be doing all this IK stuff unless he's actively attacking, trying to eat a human. So the behavior we'd want is start attacking. And then you can imagine, because we can adjust all these values at runtime, we can just start increasing that weight to make this start doing something. So instead of attacking down here, he'll now attack somewhere up here. In an upcoming video, I'm going to outline the whole Dino AI behavior tree and how all this works together. But for today, because that's a lot of extra stuff that you're probably not interested in if you're here about IK, the short answer is the T-Rex attack animation raises an animation event. And animation events are not something that just happen automatically. On your imported model, underneath animation, after you find the animation, you can add the animation events you'd like to receive. So here at frame zero, basically, I've said, hey, I want to get an animation event on this frame saying begin attack. And all of these are the optional parameters you can provide. I don't need any, so I'm not doing that. And then in our code, which has to be on the same game object as the animator, so in this case, my Dino script, we can just define a function called begin attack. And here I'm just checking some stuff like, do I have a chain IK constraint? Do I have a target object I'm trying to attack? And I wanted to not do this IK when I'm attacking a wall because it's good enough as it is. So only when I'm actually trying to eat humans. Then we set the chain IK constraint data target position to be the target transform position. And then I just added some offset because all the enemies have their transform point at their feet. And I wanted him to attack more like their body. We're then doing an IK coroutine. So if we already have one running, we stop it from running and start a new one. And down here, this is a very simple lerp chain IK weight coroutine, where based on some configurations, like how long should we lerp? What's the max weight we should take? We will basically just lerp that weight up, wait for how long we want to hold that max weight, and then lerp it back down. So I just defined a little struct here with how long do we want to hold the max weight? What is the max weight? How long should we animate in and out? And we get our target that doesn't come through the animation event. We get an event through Unity behavior where we just, as soon as we start attacking, we assign that game object target. So we always know that once we get our attack animation, we're gonna have that target to try to bite. Again, the full video is coming out soon, so make sure you're subscribed to be notified when that comes out to see how all these different components work together. However, you can see that sometimes this doesn't work, especially when a bunch of units get grouped together. It doesn't look great. He gets a little bit too close and then his IK misses. So you might be like, oh, well, we'll just make him be a little bit farther away. And yeah, you can tweak the values and have him be a little bit farther to start, but you'll always end up, at least in this game, with him potentially getting a little bit too close to the target. And then he ends up doing something weird, breaking his neck. So to solve this totally broken IK situation on the T-Rex, whenever they're going to attack, I added something called a min attack range to force a T-Rex to back up a little bit if he's too close and it just won't look good. Then he's always biting the human and he's never going into a weird spot where he's breaking his neck because he'll forcibly back himself up to make sure he hits that target. When dealing with IK, it's really important to understand the constraints that it will work with. In this case, we know that the IK should only be activated when the T-Rex begins attacking and it shouldn't immediately happen. We should lerp or over time make it stronger as the dino gets closer to attacking. And we know that we have to be within a relatively small margin of range for it to actually look good. If you're doing something like hold gun IK or touch a wall or even pick up an object, you'll likely run into very similar issues of range that it looks good and needs to be activated over. And when you're building your game with either AI units or even the player, you have to program something to make sure that those constraints are met. When I cover the Dino AI in full in a future video, you'll get the full breakdown of exactly how I manage that in this game. If you can't wait, of course, you can always check out the full project on GitHub and take a look for yourself. Another huge shout out to polyperfect for all of their support and partnership on this project. It really wouldn't be possible without them. If you got value out of this video and you want to show your support, pick up these assets. The dinos are the ultimate pack. You can use my affiliate link in the description. That helps a tremendous amount. Other ways you can show your support are you can check out my 24 plus hour RTS course where we walk through step by step how to make your very own real-time strategy game. We just launched the final section where we do some polishing off to make it look a lot nicer. You can also get some LlamAcademy merch right here on YouTube. You can also become a YouTube member or a Patreon supporter. Your recurring monthly contribution there helps tremendously. These videos and these projects take a lot of time, and I really wouldn't be able to do it without your support. If you become a supporter, you'll get your name appear on the screen at the end of every video. You'll get access to a private members exclusive Discord, and starting at the awesome tier, you'll also get a shout out like these awesome folks. Ivan, Ifiobolus, Jason Hansen, Sneddon, Trey Briggs, Will B, Mustafa, Nick5454, and Pixel Wizards. And there's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support, and I'll see you on the next video.